الحمد لله، نحمده ونشكره ونستهديه ونستغفره ونسأله العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله رحمة الله للعالمين، خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. نشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله. We praise God Allah and we bow to Him in gratitude and we ask Him humbly to give us the best in this life and in the life of eternity. And we ask Him to shower His peace and the blessing on the last of His messengers and the prophets, His mercy to the worlds, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We bear witness that there is no deity save Allah, and we bear witness that Muhammad is the servant and the messenger of Allah. Dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in His glorious Quran, in two verses repeated in the same words, in the same surah, تلك أمة قد خلت لها ما كسبت ولكم ما كسبتم ولا تسألون عما كانوا يعملون. This verse simply means those are people who passed away. They will be judged according to what they have earned. You will be judged according to what you earn. You will not be judged according to their deeds. And this verse has been repeated verbatim in Surah Al-Baqarah, in the same letter by letter, word by word, which should mean something to us. The Quran also says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدْ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. O ye who attain to faith, be aware of God and look what you have prepared for tomorrow. And be aware of God because God is aware of what you do. Quran also said, أَلَّا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. No weight bearer should bear the weight of somebody else. In these verses that I'm sharing with you, there is a directive that events are telling us that we badly need it at that particular time. And the directive is, don't be imprisoned, locked up in history. Look at the future. History is to learn from, not to be imprisoned by. History is the jumping board to the future, not the hole in which you sink and you cannot extricate yourself out. And about history, Quran talked several times to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he tells you, Muhammad, about history of other prophets in a way that will strengthen your heart. نقص عليك من أنباء الرسل ما نثبت به فؤادك. What will make you stronger? لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب. There have been in this history a lesson and admonition to those who can reflect. This is the function of history, as Quran depicts, not to live in history until it cripples you now and it prevents you from negotiating your future. The reason why we need that now is that at this stage, our ummah is going through a very difficult test of suffering and mayhem and pain simply because of things that happened in the past. And people will be divided into two kinds of people. People who live in the past, and those the maximum they can do is to maintain a status quo. And people who have their eye on the future, so they can create a change that will make tomorrow better than today, and next year better than this year. The Ummah now is tested, that test, confronting itself to know whether we want to live in the past or address the future. And I know that you know what I am alluding to. I am alluding to the Shia-Sunni schism that is taking its ugliest, most inhumane, most un-Islamic, most hurting form in Iraq today. And I know that speakers of Jum'ah, they avoid these subjects. After standing on this pulpit for about 30 years, I will never ever avoid a difficult subject because it makes us uncomfortable, because this will be a betrayal of the trust of the pulpit of the Jum'ah that is made for us to address our problems and solve our issues and plan for a better future. The situation there or in similar places is because the Ummah is looking and living in the past, not looking at the future. The Ummah is still living at the Saqifah and the Karbala and what kind of pain some people inflicted on others. And instead of taking lessons from that, so it is not repeated in the future, we are reliving the tragedy so that our present and, God forbid, our past and our future can be as tragic as this past. And this ought not to be, because this is not what Allah told us to use history for. And this is not what ma yanfa'u an-nas, what is good for people. We are supposed to do and to behave according to what is good for people. And I know that we have that tendency. Number one, to avoid the subject, to gloss over it, or to say, guess what? There is no problem. It is the enemy who is creating that whole hullabaloo and all this killing, etc., is done by the enemies. They are the ones who created the problems, etc. And this is, in my humble judgment, a very dishonest and cowardly way of facing ourselves and our issues. There are differences between Shia and Sunni in reading the history and in interpretation, and there is nothing wrong with that. And for 1400 years, there was nothing wrong with that. We still worship Allah. We still followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We still guided by the Quran, and we still direct our face to the same Qibla when we pray, and we still have the same code of ethics and morality. And you still have the same mission to serve humanity. So there are differences. And granted, there are wicked elements in that world that would like to play on this difference to make a schism and to create a chaos. But you don't blame the enemy for what the enemy is supposed to do. The job description of the enemy is to do what an enemy should do. If the enemy doesn't do what an enemy will do, he should be fired as an enemy. But it is us. Shall we enable the enemy? Shall we give them the chance and the opportunity? We are worked up emotionally for one reason, because we live in the past. We did not look at the past as تلك أمة قد خلت لها ما كسبت ولكم ما كسبتم. We did not heed the verse that says begins are begins. You can study them, you can subscribe to any way of performing your rituals or any vision of the world, as if, as long as it is within the frame of Islam. And you can say, I belong to this, or I belong to that, or I don't belong to neither one. But we cannot fight and kill and say, ah, that's the enemy doing that. No. We are not living up to the enormity of the problem so that we can nip it at the bud. And we can prevent it from spreading, and we can, at least for us as Muslim Americans, should never allow that to spill here in the United States of America. There is no excuse for that whatsoever. And when we listen to certain rhetorics, or unfortunately, as it happened in some areas, so certain, alhamdulillah, very minor events, but we should not rest until we make this hate-proof society. We should not allow that. We should not allow stupidity to take over clear thinking. We should not allow hate to kick love out of the hearts. And we claim that we are doing that in the name of believing in my way of understanding Islam. You are defying Islam altogether, whether you are a Shia or a Sunni, or you are in between. We cannot kill Islam while we are claiming that we are doing that for the sake of Islam. It doesn't work this way. And we have a duty, and we have a strong message to send. I will not tell you, send this message to Iraq, or send this message to the Muslim world, or to the muftis, or to the sheikhs, or to the imams. So many messages have been sent anyways, and we cannot tell them what to do. We are not living there. But definitely we should send the message to ourselves that this is wrong, and that wrong should be cleared and corrected in our hearts and in our minds before it reflects on our conduct and on our behavior and on our words. It is a major responsibility for Muslims. And this ought to be discussed in every Jummah and in every masjid and in every conference and in every convention, so that we don't create a taboo and we hide the dirty laundry that everybody is seeing except us. There is nothing called dirty laundry. It smells, man. It smells. So we have to, instead of hiding it, wash it out of the dirt. The dirt of hate, the dirt of stupidity, the dirt of fanaticism, and the dirt of prejudice, and the dirt of indecency in general. This is what we are supposed as Muslims to do, and this is what the Quran taught us to do, and this is what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam modeled to us to follow. Istaghfiru rabbakum, innahu huwa al-ghafuru rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. My dear brothers and sisters, I don't want you for a moment to listen to what I say and say, oh, everything is so bad, so bleak. There is no positive thing in our life, because simply this is not true. And I'd like to share you with you, as I shared with you the thought and the pain and the feeling, I want to share with you some of the efforts that inshallah will be very effective in dealing with the problem. There is no time to mention everything, but I'll just mention an example in which we are involved. That center is involved in, and it definitely for that deserves your support. And IMPACT is involved in, as well as other personalities and organizations. 2 weeks ago, we called for a meeting of leadership from the Shia brothers and from the Sunni brothers and from the brothers who are not fascinated by this classification to start with. And we met at the office of Muslim Public Affairs Council. And we got people who are really of caliber and of track record in working positively for Islam and the Muslims in the United States. We got Imam Mustafa Qazwini, and we got Brother Muzammil Siddiqui, and we got Dr. Hassan Hathout, and we got Dr. Aga Hathout, and we got Salam Marayati, and we got people from CARE, and people from Shura Council, and Brother Sadiq Allo, and the Imam Bara, he is familiar with and he represents. Different people from different sides, and we sat around the table and looked each other in the eye, and we addressed the problem as a problem, not as a chance to cry and moan and groan and shed tears. But this is a problem, and we focused on one issue. We know that the problem now is so big, but we focused on one issue, that this is not going to be allowed to spill out to the United States of America. This is the area that we can do work at. I'm not going to say I am upset because a sheikh in Saudi Arabia said an ugly statement, or a man in Iraq or Tehran said this or said that. I can't control those people. But the field we are working at is to strengthen the Muslim American identity and to build the future for our children and grandchildren, to live up proud of being Muslims, of being Americans, and capable of contributing to the positiveness of life. This is what we focused on. And we decided on several steps, and one of them is to craft a code of honor that will be binding on all of those who will accept to sign on it. And I will take some time to very briefly mention the highlights of that code. And I'll tell you why am I telling you that. After an introduction, no group or individual should use, propagate, or tolerate rhetoric of takfir, which is charge of unbelief, for anyone who believes in the oneness and supremacy of Allah, in Prophet Muhammad as the seal of the prophets, and on as the last receiver of a divine scripture, and in the viability and authenticity of the glorious Quran, and who faces the Qibla. Anyone who fits this description is a brother and sister in Islam, honored and respected, whether we agree or disagree on other issues. That was the first item. The second item, all forms of hate and condescending speech and literature shall not be allowed in our midst. Muslims shall respect each other, and the personalities and the places and the events that any group among us holds in esteem. So we will not use bad language about people or about places that any group holds in esteem. So no one should dare to insult the Sahaba, no one should dare to insult Ahlul Bayt, no, and so on and so forth. Number four, with respect to minor differences in performing ibadat, the one who visits a mosque of a majority of a certain group should perform according to this majority. Muslims shall use reasonable measure to prevent the dissemination of imported material that are adding fuel to the fire. Muslims should remember that they are accountable to the one who knows the whisper of themselves to themselves, who is closer to them than their heart blood vessels, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why am I telling you that? So that, number one, in this center we report to the constituencies everything we do. Number two, I am asking you to support these institutions that are carrying this endeavor, whichever way you want support. Number three is to know that the most difficult thing is to take a first step. We took a first step, so there is hope. Muslims, don't lose hope. And we will ask you for your dua. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide our footsteps to the right path. I ask Him to forgive our shortcomings and our mistakes. I ask Him to give us the intelligence of the mind and the courage of the heart and the purity of the soul to be worthy of receiving the Quran and following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا وعافنا واعف عنا وتولنا تب علينا ودافع عنا وادفع عنا كل شر وكل سوء وصل اللهم على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أقم الصلاة.